The Supreme Court is winding down its term, and so there's going to be a flood of decisions coming our way. But today was a monumental decision on the scale of Citizens United. Today, the court decided 6-3 to legalize government officials taking a form of bribery. And yes, there are absolutely no surprises on how that 6-3 split went. The conservative majority voted to legalize bribery, and the liberal justices dissented. Now, Democrats have been advocating for months that both Alito and Thomas should recuse themselves from cases involving Trump, especially since Ginny Thomas, wife of Clarence Thomas, was directly involved in the fake electors plan. She communicated directly with Trump's chief of staff, Mark Meadows. Hello, Merrick Garland. Plenty of evidence. Or are you afraid Faux News and Newsmax will accuse you of weaponizing the Justice Department? And let's not forget about Alito and his flag flying, which he blames on his wife. The Trump immunity decision is obviously going to be the biggest decision to come out of the court this term. But today's decision is not exactly chopped liver, and it's all about money and politics. So Alito and Thomas should have recused themselves on principle alone. But when you get into the specifics of this case, you discover that it's not just abstract principle. You'll find that both Thomas and Alito are guilty of the very crime that came before the court. Yes, that's correct. If the court had not overruled the appeals court decision on Snyder versus U.S., Thomas and Alito would be guilty, saved only by the fact that the decision applied to state, county, and municipal officials only. Thomas and Alito have both accepted enormous gifts from friends, who then just coincidentally have cases come before the court. Thomas, for example, has accepted at least 38 vacations, 26 private jet flights, 8 flights by helicopter, a dozen VIP passes to sporting events, as well as stays at luxury resorts in Florida and Jamaica, as well as an exclusive all-male retreat in California, a ranch in Texas, and a vacation home in the Adirondacks. And that's leaving out the motorhome he received from Harlan Crow, not to mention the purchase of his mother's home at above market value, and then allowing her to live in it rent-free. Now, Alito is small potatoes compared to Thomas, but still, he was comped for a 3-day stay at an Alaska fishing resort that charges $1,000 a day, and he was flown there by private jet, which would have cost him $100,000. Now, technically, you cannot call these gifts bribes because there was no direct quid pro quo. Quid pro quo. Where have we heard that before?
No quid pro quo.
No quid pro quo.
Quid pro quo.
Quid pro quo.
No quid pro quo.
So because there was no direct exchange of gifts for a specific ruling, these gifts are not technically bribes. And that's what today's case, Snyder versus U.S., is all about. In 1984, Congress passed a law, and Ronald Reagan signed it, that outlawed gratuities to public officials on the state, county, and local levels. The Supreme Court decision defined the difference between bribes and gratuities this way. Bribes are typically payments made or agreed to before an official act in order to influence the public official with respect to that future official act. Gratuities are typically payments made to a public official after an official act as a reward or token of appreciation. The reason for the distinction is because Snyder was the mayor of Portage, Indiana, and he was convicted in federal court for accepting $13,000 after he awarded a contract to Great Lakes Peterbilt for purchasing 5 garbage trucks costing $1.1 million. Snyder claimed the money was for consulting services, and there's nothing in Indiana state law or Portage municipal law that prohibits government employees from working outside their jobs. A federal jury said, "Nah, dude, that was a convenient thing to say. You're guilty of accepting a gratuity." So today, the majority on the court ruled that the law Congress passed in 1984 is unconstitutional. And why is it unconstitutional? Because the majority argued that the 1984 law would significantly infringe on bedrock federalism principles. In other words, the states' rights federalists just smacked down on the U.S. government imposing bribery laws on the states. And what's so wrong with that? Listen to the hand-wringing of the majority. A federal prohibition on gratuities would suddenly subject 19 million state and local officials to a new and different regulatory regime for gratuities. The court should hesitate before concluding that Congress prohibited gratuities that state and local governments have allowed. Regime? Seriously, regime? Congress made it illegal to accept gratuities for anyone in government. But that's this Supreme Court's version of a regime? Yes, what kind of a fascist world do we want to live in, where money is excluded from politics? What kind of Stalinist dictatorship would prevent someone like, Clarence Thomas and his wife, being flown to Indonesia on a private jet when their work year is done? Well, the liberal justices exposed the BS of the majority. Justice Jackson, in her clear and direct style, smacked the majority and their federalism right in the face. She wrote, "Officials who use their public positions for private gain threaten the integrity of our most important institutions. Greed makes governments, at every level, less responsive, less efficient, and less trustworthy from the perspective of the communities they serve." That is the issue, plain and simple, and it's exactly why Congress wrote a law in 1984 to ban gratuities at the state, county, and local levels. It was already illegal on the federal level. So no hand-wringing from Jackson, no remorse for simpler times, and no respect for federalism. Jackson's opening was a simple jab at the majority, but then she delivered the haymaker, stating, "Snyder's absurd and atextual reading of the statute is one only today's court could love. Ignoring the plain text of Section 666, which, again, expressly targets officials who corruptly solicit, accept, or agree to accept payments intending to be influenced or rewarded. The court concludes that the statute does not criminalize gratuities at all." She then goes on to say, "The court's reasoning elevates non-existent federalism concerns over the plain text of this statute and is a quintessential example of the tail wagging the dog." Unfortunately for our country, Jackson calling out the majority has no immediate effect on the Supreme Court making gratuities, which is just another form of bribery, perfectly legal. The fact remains, however, that accepting gratuities is illegal for federal government officials. So again, Merrick Garland, why aren't you doing your job? The first debate between Biden and Trump is only a day away, and already the right-wing echo chamber is starting up with, "A vote for Biden is a vote for a Kamala Harris presidency." As if that were MAGA World's worst nightmare. Wrong. Get your nightmares straight, you right-wing bubbleheads. Your worst nightmare isn't Harris as president. It's Harris as AG. She'd come after all of you seditionists and corrupt government officials. Ted Cruz would be back to Cancun so fast your head would spin. Psst, Ted, we have extradition with Mexico. So for now, as with Citizens United, the right-wing dominated Supreme Court has just announced that when it comes to money and politics, let the games begin. I'm Anthony Vincent Gallo for Occupy Democrats.